I'm at a hospital board meeting.
So was it actually,
Well, I don't know, because the letter I got from Dr. Hutchinson says he has 2 weeks.
Oh, Chris must have left it, because, Chris must have left it, because.
Kelly Somervell has 2 weeks and cannot work.
Oh, my gosh, that's hilarious.
Thanks, goodness.
Open his work in his office.
Protecting that hip.
Yeah, I'll do tomorrow, because he won't be here tomorrow either.
All right, so you'll see that.
Okay.
Dr. Burris is on the way, if you want to go ahead and start. Since you have lack of patience.
I say we go ahead and start, and we'll, by the time we get in the pickup, she'll probably be here. All right, let's show that it is 6:01 on November 20th. August 20th, 2015. It's a Thursday, so we will call this meeting to order. Show that Dr. Burrows is absent, all of the board members present. Item number three, discuss and if necessarily take action on the issuance of a request for proposal for the sale of a plot of land for an investor to construct the laundry facility. So basically, 30 minutes ago, we had a building committee meeting, and I think the consensus was is to bring this before the board and kind of discuss. Ray, bring us up to speed on what the plan is.
Yeah, we've been talking with the nursing home representatives, and they have an interest in building a laundry facility, primarily for their own use, but it would be available for us to use either on a per pound basis, like we're currently paying another vendor, or we could work out some sort of arrangement on a percentage of cost. But they want to build the facility regardless of our participation in it. And in order to do that, they need to buy the property. Their lender has told them they have to own the property. They'll be buying about 8,000 square feet of land. And what they're looking at is, it's right over here. We have, there's a little rock house, which we call the wash house, because there's laundry goes on there. Now, that is on a plot of land, about 12,000 square feet, I believe. They want to buy about 8,000 square feet. We don't know exactly, because they've got to look at the size of their building, and then they've got to talk to the city to see if they have to provide their own parking or if they are not. So it would be up to, probably up to about 8,000 square feet. We talked with the CAD in terms of what the fair market value of that might be, because we think that any time we issue an RFP, that we have to receive at least fair market value for that property. So our intention would be to issue an RFP for an investor to purchase land and build a laundry facility on that property, or sell it, that'd be up to 8,000 square feet at 60 cents. I don't know if there's other investors in town that would have an interest in that, but certainly if they, if someone else expressed an interest, they could submit an RFP, and then you would be faced with making a decision.
So any questions or discussion about
that? So RFP currently is just selling the land. It has nothing to do with the actual agreement. Of them building something and being available to us or anything
well,
like that?
I think the RFP says that we sell 8,000 square feet specifically for someone to build a laundry.
Yes, yes.
That way we don't have somebody, because fair market value on the piece of land is 60 cents a square foot. Talking about a 4,800 square foot lot, I mean a lot at 4,800 square feet, I want 100 of them.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So, you know.
Well, the RFP would include, to purchase the land for the specific reason of building a laundry facility.
And Ron, I think you kind of pointed out, we can be specific in what we sell the land for. We'll have to declare the land surplus.
Well, I'm saying that's what the county has to do. That's my experience there. I'm not saying that it's exactly the same for a special district. I would suspect it was, but I'm just suggesting that requesting that we check with Kevin Reed and find out if it's the same rules.
Right. But if not, I mean, it'd be a great location for a snow cone stand or something. So let's specify that a laundry has to be, that a medical grade laundry has to be built there.
And we would not specify any ability of ourselves to use such.
I don't think so. I think that's a separate contract.
Yes.
Of course, by the same token, how do we know they don't go crazy 6 months from now and start trying to charge us double for laundry? Would certainly give us the ability to go outside and go back to the public for laundry rather than having them down here locally. I don't think that's ever going to happen, but.
So, you know, the way the laundry facility works right now, or the laundry works, is the contract is in our name, and we, you know, we pay for it, and the nursing home reimburses us. I'm right about that, right, Michael? Yeah. So, sort of the issue you have is that contract expires in the middle of October, so both of us are going to have to find a temporary vendor for our laundry services. Either get a short-term extension on our current vendor, or find another vendor for a shorter period of time.
And long-term, worst-case scenario, we're going to save $12,000 on laundry, possibly as much as 24, depending on what the new company would negotiate with us on our laundry, et cetera, which they've been talking a rate increase, but I don't think it was double on our part, but it certainly would be something higher.
But both the nursing home and we think that there are dollars to be saved either with this venture or with us going to another vendor and negotiating.
Right.
To get that another vendor, we have to do a lot of a longer term contract. But I mean, from our perspective, we'll issue the RFP, see, it comes back, see what it looks like, and then y'all make the decision as to where you want to go from there. But certainly getting an RFP doesn't bind us to selling the property. It just finds out who's interested.
Well, I certainly think if we're going to put it on an RFP and our contract dies in October, now's a good time.
We're definitely gonna have to.
Well, we've kind of pushed the nursing home into doing this, and I will say this in their defense, that Brian Thomas and Ricky Villa, it's my understanding that they've bought two other nursing home facilities recently, and so I guess they kind of had bigger fish to fry than working on the laundry.
So what recourse does the hospital district have if the person makes the deal, they sign the paperwork, they get the land, and they change their mind?
Sorry.
If they decide not to turn it into a laundry facility after they sign the paperwork, you know?
I don't think they can. I think they build a laundry or they don't.
That was part of the deal that they signed up for, and I'm not exactly sure. I mean, never had that situation come up in the county, but you know, if they didn't do that, I think we'd have the right to undo the deal, so to speak.
And specifying a medical grade laundry would preclude them from putting in a Maytag.
Right? I mean, we're only talking about $4,800 probably, or something like that. So you know, we have a situation where we say, okay, we give you your money back, you give the land back to us.
Right.
Does it have to be part of their proposal to do it, and then they face it basically being breach of contract?
It sounds to me like we need to do it and soon.
Is that a motion or is that a thought?
So far it's just a thought. I had to check with this guy. What do you think? I think she's in some agreement. How about if I move it and then see what happens?
All right, so John's made a motion that we do this. Is there a second to John's motion?
I'll second it.
All right, so we have a motion and a second to issue an RFP about the laundry. Any discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, same sign. Show Paul abstained. Also, let the record reflect that Dr. Burroughs showed up and Dr. Burroughs did participate in the vote. All right, item number four is to work on our 2016 budget workshop. At this point, I'm going to turn it over to Ray, and then he can figure out whether Becky's under the bus or Michael or who.
I'll start off just to give you a little bit of an overview, and let me just say, start with, you know, I'm doing some of the talking, but the Becky's done all the heavy lifting in terms of putting the budget together, and she's responsible, and she's done a remarkable job. Let me just say that she's done a remarkable job. But not only her, but we've had excellent participation from all of our department managers in terms of their participation in this. Okay. Let's talk about the revenue slip. The vast majority of our time tonight we want to spend looking at the individual departmental expenses. But I want to talk a little bit about the revenue and what we've done, because we do have some sort of preliminary bottom line numbers. On our hospital inpatient revenue and our outpatient revenue and senior care, those are all budgeted at flat, at where we are this year. You can see, you know, we're within, you know, just a few dollars from where we are. So our annualized hospital inpatient revenue, 8.749 million, and we're budgeting right now 8.85 million for next year. And we don't anticipate changing that number. You know, that's about 50. It's 49.8 admissions per month. That's 50 admissions per month. Last year we budgeted 65, and we're averaging right at 48 a month right now. We don't think that number should change at all, because the business is moving from inpatient to outpatient. I think that's a good number, but I think it should be the same. Now, outpatient is a little bit different. That number you see there is pretty flat from where we were year to date annualized. I will say, we went back and looked at it, and this year's outpatient revenue compared to 2014 revenue, that has increased by 5.34%. So there's been an increase in 5.34% revenue on an outpatient basis compared to prior year. And I said all that to say, because we'll at some point in time we'll be talking about increases in revenue. We think there's an opportunity to increase that outpatient revenue. We're not going to say about 5%. We think 2% would be a conservative number on that. The other thing related to revenues, we haven't had a rate increase, you know, since we think 2010. We haven't had one. And you need to continue to have rate increases for a couple reasons. And one of them, we have one payer that pays us on a percent of charges. So we want to make sure that we're keeping those rates up. We also want to make sure that we're staying somewhat competitive with our competitors on that. But the other thing, the third thing on that is that make sure that we're being paid, we're charging at least as much as we're being paid by our insurance companies. So the insurance companies are going to pay us lower of charges or whatever their negotiated rate is. So we think that there's an opportunity for us to increase, and our recommendation will be that we have at least a 5% rate increase on October 1st. Any questions on revenue? I mean, just want to kind of introduce that, we'll kind of come back to it. Discounts allowance is a big number. It's, you know, it's 70% of our charges. So you'll see from a budget standpoint, we got 42,964,000 of revenue, and that only delivers 11,775,000 of collectible revenue, net revenue. Okay, what our intention then is to go through each individual department and look at the expense, and some of them will look at revenue a little bit, but we'll look at the expense of everyone, and if you're ready, we're ready to start that process. Okay, let's start off with administration.
All right.
Salaries are flat on that. I want to go through and just let you look at them a little bit. Health insurance is a big number for us. You'll see some increases in health insurance. The increases are primarily related to additional participation. And you'll see that in some of the support departments, maybe housekeeping, for instance, where that increase is fairly significant on health insurance. There's a very small increase, well, actually there's no increase in our per member per month. Am I right about that?
Right.
But there is increase in that total expense because of increased participation, and a lot of that has to do just what's going on with the, you know, with the country and health insurance. We're welcome any line item question that you have. A couple of big numbers is the audit number is a big number. There's really two big pieces of that. One of them is the actual audit expense we pay for the financial audit. But the majority of that, come on in, Edison.
Yes.
The majority of that expense is related to consulting help with our outside accountant, preparing the cost reports, any other analysis that we have them do on a regular basis. Attorney fees are still fairly steep. It's less than it was prior prior year, but still, you know, we're running about, annualized about $37,000, and so we're budgeting $38,000 on that, a little less than we budgeted last year.
Our audit is an annualized figure, however, it's around the end of the year when we actually get the audit done, is that going to break?
That's right, yeah.
Annualized might not be real good?
I'm sorry.
Is that going to actually throw your annualized off, or did you take that into consideration for your annualized?
Well, it would match up year to year. Yeah, the expense would match up year to year because the audit report, they bill us on an interim basis. They don't wait until they complete the audit to bill us. They'll start their work in October, and they'll start billing us in October. Then they won't complete it until May, and then we'll get the final billing in May, but it's billed as they complete the work. Did I answer that question? I'm not sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's got a full year's worth of expense. The full year's worth of expenses are represented here.
There are some expenses that we moved out of administration. So we moved our PR expense out of administration to its own department. We moved our volunteer department into its own department. You'll see them separately.
This is like the big book we got last year, right? The big red book.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, and let me say that, yeah, this is sort of funny. Whenever we present the budget for y'all's approval, you know, at the October the first meeting, it'll have all the other things, cash flow statement and all the other requirements that need to be there.
Right, just like last year.
Yeah, just like last year.
I like
yep.
That.
Yep.
That was actually very beneficial.
Okay. Anything there that you want to talk about?
Yeah, item number last on there.
Purchase services.
Uh-huh.
You know, it looks like we spent $100,000. We're going to budget $80,000. Was there something that we cut out there that we can save the other $17,500?
Well, we moved some of the expense. See, that I've got some notes over here on the side, and I apologize because they go out pretty far. But if you look up at the top, you can see the whole note. So we moved 1,560 press and gaining charges is now over in quality. We moved 6,300 of our new policy tech is also going to hit quality now. We've moved some things around.
Right.
And also vending
okay.
concepts will now be in dietary.
Okay.
And this, when I put these notes out here, this isn't everything, but it's the bulk of it. So you can kind of see why. You can see where we pay some real CAD, $40,000 a year, mm-hmm. Chief of Staff, so on and so forth.
Go back up to the very top.
Okay.
Page before that one.
Summary page?
No.
Oh, the DNA?
It was, I think, even further up than that. The very first line was talking about the senior care.
Mm-hmm.
And
the
number jumped up $198,000 or something on that.
980, are you talking about? The
revenue?
Yeah,
the budget at 742.
Yeah.
274.
But
yes.
See what I'm saying? How much different those numbers are than what annualized was. You know what I mean?
Annualized is
979.
Yeah.
Right.
So we budgeted for 980.
Right.
Last year's budget was 742, but they've way exceeded that.
Right. Okay.
Hospital housekeeping, please call extension 426. Hospital housekeeping, 426.
Right, that was
does that make sense to me?
Right. Yeah, it does. Okay. It's just those two numbers were just really skewed after going through it. You know, they were.
You're talking about these two numbers right here, these two columns
yeah.
right here?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right. Well, they've done really well, so we're hoping they continue to do that,
right.
maybe even better.
Right. We're going to spend their excess money.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah.
I think she's going to spend her excess money for that thing she's got out there to deal with the parking lot.
I'm not sure if we were done with admin, but.
Yeah, we tried to go through and summarize everyone, and yeah, there's significant decrease in admin expenses, but recognize that the vast majority of that is in reallocation. It's not that we've actually reduced admin expenses by $190,000. I'd like to take the credit, but I won't.
You gonna move on to the business office? Yes, please. Yes, okay.
What we've done on all salaries, except admin, what we've done on all salaries is we've budgeted the annualized salary plus a 2% a salary increase. And that's what's in the budget.
And that was approved at a previous board meeting, right?
Sir?
No, that rate was approved by the board, right?
Well, but that was the increase for 2015. This is budgeting at 2%. And I'll be real candid, Ray and I had the discussion today about what would be a good idea, you know, how did he think the board wanted to do the raise? Of course, I'm the only one there, but here's my opinion. Is I suggested to Ray that he get with his department managers and come up with a criteria. Last year was budget. Well, they've proven that they can handle the budget. So my suggestion was, and this is just my suggestion, that if they can maintain their budget from last year, which will keep us below budget from what we were in 14, if that makes any sense, but then maybe add some other stuff to it, some education or whatever, and come up with, you know, volunteer work in the community and that kind of stuff, and come up with a cafeteria type plan that does. And so we just kind of bounced ideas around and whatnot, but there will be some sort of a criteria, I believe, this year to get the raise that is tied to something positive that's going on here. And that is just my thoughts, you know. I'm not asking anybody to, you know, scrub extra toilets or something, but just to make sure that everybody's happy.
The deal we made with the department managers last year is, you know, there's not a raise budget, you gotta earn it, and they did, you know. And so we're talking along the same thing, okay, we're gonna have the same philosophy. I don't think it'd be the right challenge to say you gotta reduce your expenses, you know, by another $500,000 to get it, but we're talking about some other type of criteria. Again, so okay, yeah, we have to think about whether or not we left the number in the budget or not. Just from a budgeting standpoint, we would say it wouldn't be automatic. You'd have to earn it. You'd have to meet the criteria in order to get the 2% raise.
Right, and I don't really have a say in that. I don't care, because I figure that's administration's deal. Let them figure it out and solve that problem.
Yeah.
I thought that was tied to the vote we had a few meetings ago.
No.
The raise was approved, and I thought.
No, I think that's a separate decision we make every year.
But how? Who gets it? And how? That's up to.
Oh, department.
Oh, absolutely.
That's administration's decision. I don't think we
and,
should.
Yes, and. And correct me if I'm wrong here, but the way that works, each department gets 2% of what their salary is for that department. If they've got this super duper employee that's just superhuman in their abilities here at the hospital, they can get more than 2%. If you've got an extremely low performing employee, they get 0%. And so they have the ability to take 2% of the $100,000 that their department has, for example, and so they have $2,000 worth of raises to give out within just their department. And so I think every raise is given out based on the department head making that decision. I don't think Ray necessarily looks on it and says, oh, you know, I like Fred and I don't like John, and so this is how they come out. It's whoever their direct supervisor is. And I assume Ray is in charge of giving the raises to the department heads since he's right over them.
And there is evaluation that goes with that. I want to point out here on you see the equipment, a significant decrease there, and that really has to do with our new copy machine contracts, and there'll be some continuing savings come along, but there's you know this significant savings with just renegotiating all of our copy machine contracts. See there, and this, you know, there's not any allocation here really. I mean, see the bottom line, there's a $42,000 decrease in expenses for the business office.
Where's the CAD expenses going to show up at?
That was under admin,
yeah,
over here.
So does that take into account their adjusted budget and our percentage of that?
I know that's in this year. That additional, that is their budget, which they presented to us.
Okay.
Which y'all approved. Yeah, that's the number.
They have not yet presented the excess for legal fees.
No. We approved that.
That was
it. We approved that. That's in this year's numbers.
The whole thing.
Well, the additional the additional allocation for them to get $1 million in this $1 million of attorney fees, but that was allocated out. And that was part of that proposal, I guess, at the last meeting that y'all approved. There's two pieces of that. One was the annual budget, the other was a revision of the current budget for this year.
And I think our part was like an $11,000 increase or something.
Yeah.
I think. Per
mortar.
Yeah.
was it per quarter?
No, was it?
Yeah, it's 11,000 was what our portion of the legal fees were gonna be to deal with the ESH.
It's a one-time assessment, yeah.
Right.
So that's gonna cover everything we got with them for next year?
Yes. Unless they revise their budget.
They may have to.
Were we finished with the business office, or?
I am.
All right, if I go ahead and somebody has a question, we can go back. This is HR, Human Resources.
Did we give them more equipment, is that why the rent's up?
The rent equipment?
Yeah, rent equipment.
Well, we just use the annualized figure, this is what they, this year's expense, so we kept it the same.
And again, that department, that 14,000 decrease, that's a decrease over budget this year compared to budget last year.
Right.
You see, it's a slight increase.
These two.
That's what that is, so. Okay.
All right.
What are purchase services in HR?
LaDonna.
It's IT.
Are you for sale?
Careful.
Is that IT expense?
That is IT expense. We have numerous spy feeds up every Friday, and they charge us for them. And we do, Becky does some, of course, keep from getting charged, but we still get quite a bit.
Purchase services is just kind of the last item.
Yeah, you'll see it in every, yeah, you'll see it in every department.
It's like the DOC of the hospital department. DOC is the dumping ground for the government, everything gets dumped in the department.
No, it's all the IT, purchase services.
In your, on your department, yeah.
Mine is no 100 DOC.
Okay.
All right. Medical records?
See, significantly started health insurance, and that's related to dispatch. People did take it last year, they're here this year.
So just to kind of jump on the travel expense while we're thinking about it, I know I discussed this with Becky previously about us having standards for travel and what the expenses should be or what realm they should be in. I don't know if you guys have that or not. I know that that's something we had where I worked, where you went to a city and you had a certain range of, you were allowed to spend for hotel nights and for food and all that kind of stuff, so that you didn't just go out and spend $75 buffets every night.
We talked about that today, and a couple of things. One of them is not very much travel, but the other is, you know, any travel expense, any meeting attendance has to be prior approved. We recommend and suggest that if you're going to a conference, that you stay at the hotel that is sponsoring the conference. Generally, there's a rate that's negotiated for that, and then also you don't have the additional travel expense. We do not have a per diem on the meals for a couple reasons. And most of the conferences now, the meals are a lot of the meals are prepared are part of the meeting. The other is, from my perspective, our people are very conservative whenever they go to a conference. And what we ask them to do is that, you know, eat as if you were paying for it, but you know. We don't pay for any alcohol. We make that, and we from time to time had a receipt that'll come in and have alcohol. We don't pay for it. We take it off. But you know, then all travel expenses have to be approved by a member of administration before they're paid. So I guess we're a little reluctant to do the per diem on the bill because you know it's going to be $30. You know, if that's your per diem, and I can tell you that. Lots of times our people don't spend $30. You know,
lots of times you can't eat $30.
But we talked about that, and I think from a, you know, we're putting together kind of a little broad policy on that. But you know that's a, you know, we pay mileage. If people you know travel by car, we pay mileage. If they fly coach, and we book most of those airfares through our office on that.
Roughly about how much travel expense do we do a year in all the departments?
You know, I'm not sure of the total, I can't off the top of my head, but I know that in each department, we have certain conferences, like Kelly and the IT, they'll go to the CPSI conference every year. A lot of it is the same basic conference, so not every department's gonna have travel, but we pretty much know ahead of time what we spend, so we kept it as flat as possible.
We get that number for you, it's a modest amount, I'll tell you, it's a very modest amount.
So how come there's only like a few lines here where this one was within budget? How did the budget get so out of whack on this particular one?
What are you comparing? I'm sorry, which columns are you comparing?
Okay, well, if you look at
row 20.
Payroll tax is one of the things line 7, is that one of the ones you're looking at?
Yeah.
So are you looking at each
that's
line?
That's a big one where they... Yeah, they allowed, looks like they spent $11,651 in 9/30/2015. You see what I'm saying? And then the
only budget $15,50.
I can attest to that one. That was I caught that after budget approval, and it was a typo. It was supposed to be $15,500.
I started saying, you know,
I caught it after looking through and knew what it was, but we haven't made a budget adjustment to account for that, but it was supposed to be $15,500.
So that means that the number at the bottom of that 11021 is going to be 13.5 off, so it's really going to be a $24,000 increase in expense?
Well, since the actual budget number was 15, that's what we put in the budget, it is right. What it is, it's 11, but yes, it should have been.
Yeah, the real number looked there is the second column and the last column, because that's actual performance this year compared to budget.
Okay, I
see. That's right, slightly under.
But the actual budget total in there on line 20 for the 2015 budget actually assumed 1,500 instead of 15,000.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Couldn't tell your spreadsheet. Oops.
Well, everything had already been approved whenever I ran across that one, and you know, to change one line item in the budget.
Hard enough to get us to approve it the first time.
But there's a couple of little, you know, when you're doing this many, there's a couple.
Central supply is next. And this is the first department, this is the first department we're getting to where you'll see the top lines, anything that starts, if you see the column says CPSI, it starts with a 3, that's revenue. The 4s are expense, the 5, you know, the discounts, allowance, and other income.
Holy mother, what happened to emergency revenue?
No. This is central
supply.
Right, where it says emergency.
In central supply, $23,715 of revenue.
Which was probably...
annualized for last year was $242.
And a lot of that is a product of if they move things out and actually distribute them out of the ER versus central supply, going and getting them every day. And when they start making those changes, you don't realize what it does to the budget. The budget as a whole captures all of it, but when you move something, you know, when you used to, you check all the IV supplies out of central, just as an example, but all the IV fluid, you checked out of central supply, so it went from there to ER and then was charged out. But then if ER started housing it all themselves, it moves all that over to ER.
Our supply is decentralized.
Yeah.
It would probably make a lot more sense if we just looked at revenue as you know, one line and just combined all that, because it is a little bit
confusing. That's a bad thing with budget. When you make a slight move that you think is minor, you don't realize the trickle-down effect it has in other
things. Yes, I understand.
Again, revenue is budget flat. You'll see when we get over to the med service that we've increased the swing bed revenue quite a bit, because that's a new service for us, so we plan for that.
Well, now you're ready.
Yeah.
This is the quality department. in here, I'll click on this, yep, it's down at the top. This is just where we talked previously about moving some of the expenses over to quality that had been in a different department.
Just so you know, Dr. Smith is a physician who comes in and reviews our charts for us. An independent physician that comes in and reviews, you know, reviews charts on the other physicians. Pretty straightforward. But again, you know, just a small decrease in a total expense for the program.
And this department did take on another FTE?
There's one and a
one and a
half FTE there.
But last year in your budget was one and a half last year?
It was one and a half, yes, okay, sir.
For some reason, I thought you picked up another FTE or another half FTE.
Mm-mm. I would love to take a full time. Are we ready? Y'all need to hold up. Y'all need to hold up. So I'm going to tell you when you're ready to go. Our IT department.
And that's the bulk of your purchase services?
The purchase services, this is what it's, we spend this much, $124,000 in CPSI. We also spend some money with VizProtech, which totals about $150,000.
Right.
And this is our employee. This we have a full-time employee that's in here.
Right. So now we have salaries and health insurance that we, you know, we didn't have last year. On this line, the dues and subscriptions, we are adding malware, which was $2,100, and upgrading our Zimbra email, which is $1,000. And $100 for, I can't remember what it was, NAC?
National Association of CPSI.
I think I did actually that yesterday and I already forgot, but anyway. So that's been budgeted in. There was no budget for that last year.
Before we ask her why we're traveling, $4,000.
If you notice, I didn't use it this year. I didn't send them to the CPSI conference.
Oh my goodness, that's so funny though. All right, this is senior care. Again, the top line is the revenue line.
Before we've got this pulled up here, I think they almost have an immediate need for transportation over there. Did she budget that into her budget when she was working on this, or was that something that would go into capital improvements later?
Capital items.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, I didn't know if that would, hers is such a different budget than the other departments because it's kind of its own thing out there, and I didn't know if there was, I was kind of looking to see if there was a place in there for that. And her purchase services is so high because of the psychologist that
Dr. McCarthy.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. And you can see here on in this department, obviously they've done really well, but there's going to be an increase in net revenue down at the bottom and a decrease in expense. This is one we're real proud of. They've done a great job out there. And she's had those bands on her capital requests okay. for about, I don't know,
at least as long as I've been
four
here.
4 or 5 years? Yeah.
Yeah, but I think 3 or 4 years ago that was probably a wish list, and I think 2 or 3 years ago it would have been realized, but I think
now
that they're a little bit long in the tooth.
Yeah, well, yes. Yeah. That is
good. Any questions?
Okay. This is, not really a new department, but we've made some changes to this. We used to call this special events, but now that we have Lisa doing public relations, we have made, you know, we've kind of converted this to her department. So her salary and benefits will hit here. And then she kind of came up with the numbers of some of the things that she wants to do specifically in the new year. So all these numbers over here for general supplies, advertising, marketing, and so on, those are numbers that she came up with after, you know, she calculated what she wanted to spend on different events.
Well, since you've kind of created this department this year, is the annualized, did that come out before she spent it last year and we brought it over here, or is that?
The annualized is the only change here is that we didn't used to have salaries and employee benefits in this department, but all the other expense lines, the only change is instead of saying special events, it now says public relations. So for special events, we had, you know, raw food. She's like, nope, don't need raw food. You know, things like that, drugs. She said they don't need any drugs. No, just you. We used to budget in here for the flu shots, but now, and that's flu shots for employees, and that's also flu shots for the drive-by flu thing that we do. Now that's being split between employee health, that portion, you know, portion of it for employee health, and the other is hitting in the general, you'll see later, the general department under special events.
What happened to her health insurance?
Pardon me?
What happened to the health insurance?
She does not take health insurance. She says her man does that.
Yeah.
Her man does that for her. Yeah, I don't know. I guess he's got really good insurance.
I understand.
Yeah, so I guess that could change, but she didn't make any indication that it would, so we didn't budget for it. And the reason it had health insurance is, remember, we had Ashley before Lisa, sure. And she did take insurance. So that's what you're seeing there. Is that mine? Sorry. Are we ready?
So really, you're spending less money.
Yep.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. 5,000, of course, 2,500 of that came out of the health insurance, but the other 2,500 was nickels and dimes that she's taken someplace else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, she's not buying drugs, that helps.
Stop buying drugs.
Yeah, it's expensive. Anytime it's not buying drugs, it's better.
Are y'all ready for laundry?
I think we are.
October. Yes, we are. So this is the laundry department. This is tiny. We have one person in our laundry department. And purchase services would be what we are spending now with Southwest Linen.
Is that just our portion, or is that us and the nursing home both, and then that shows back to the
It's just ours, right. When we bill out, when we invoice them for their part, it comes out of that. So that's our net.
So is that lower because we're budgeting less number of heads per month? Is that why that number is lower?
It's lower because we're renewing our contract in October, and either way, whether we go with the nursing home or if we choose a separate vendor, our cost will go down from our current vendor. So we've already got pricing, we're starting to get more, we've got partial pricing from other vendors that would show a cost savings over Southwest Linen's, our current vendor. So
the linen services are like DirecTV. If you sign up and you're the new customer, they give you a real good deal the first year. And it gets higher and higher and higher until you're in the long-term contract. The last year's not a good year to be in. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so next is housekeeping. And as Ray pointed out, you'll see a big change in health insurance. A lot of the housekeepers last year did not have insurance, and they took it this year. So there has been an increase. Clinic. Let's let's see, some of the changes here. Our specialty doctors used to be across the street where Dr. Lawton is now, and they've moved over to our cardio department. So, you know, that rent has gone away from them. That's now reflected on Dr. Lawton's financials. So they don't have the building rent, rental equipment, so on and so forth. Let's see, purchase service. Oh, this is what we, this purchase service is what we allocate from housekeeping for to go there and clean Dr. Schmidt Burroughs' offices. And then the line underneath where it says rental income, that's what we charge our specialty doctors for their rent.
Why their revenue go down somewhere? Why are we projecting their revenue to go down somewhere?
Well, we're not charging them nearly as much when they, you know, they came over from across the street, so they have, you know, we were charging them more because they had more space over there.
Right.
But their rent, their invoices have come down significantly.
Right.
Is this the area that's upstairs here in this part?
The cardio. Yes, they come over here to cardio. They all have different days they come on, and so it's worked out real nice.
But it is a little bit smaller.
But it's
across
smaller.
The street, but it's
definitely smaller. Susan, is Dr. Virgo still, or did he go, is he?
He's going across the street. He started going over there when we did the renovation because it was easier.
Yeah.
And he just likes staying where he is.
Oh.
So do we have an agreement with the group that Dr. Burroughs is with to clean her office?
Mm-hmm. Yes, we do. And she pays right on time.
You're charging too much.
It's always good to get the other side of the equation here during the discussion. It's good to hear that.
I've said it before, the whole President's Award thing, I'll tell you what it really started, my first deal, was how good our housekeeping crew does do. And it was just, I've been thousands of these type of selfies. This one's as clean or cleaner than nearly everyone I've ever been in. And
okay, we'll move over to Pecan, Paul's favorite.
The big number down there is the rent increase, and we've allocated the additional space that we're processing leasing out there.
Right, this right here on the where it says building rent, this is now, we were actually splitting the rent of the new area between Pecan and Peters and Carpenter, or not Peters anymore, but it'll be somebody else. But there is a little bit of an increase in each one of those departments.
Yeah, the new agreement, the rent shot up $6,000 a month in September, starting in September.
Yeah, there'll be some allocated over to physical therapy.
Oh, yeah, right, exactly. Yes.
Do you think that's going to be enough advertising on line 23 there? Because certainly we're going to have to spend more than that advertising two new doctors. And
true, but all of our advertising has gotten moved. We've moved all of it over to Lisa's department. She's going to handle all the advertising, whether it's a help wanted ad or whatever.
Right.
We also have advertising in the 501A budget. So when we do advertising, we advertise jointly. And when we advertise 501A, we advertise both the Glen Rose Clinics and the Con.
Yeah.
So back to the rent here. So it says budget $20,000 rent for the year, but I saw that it's $6,000 a month in the contract starting in September. So you say next to that, annual is $60,000 divided by Con, Carpenter, and Dr. Lizette.
Ray, where did we get the $60,000? I thought we looked at the...
The other portion of that is the physical therapy part. The pharmacy part is housed in physical therapy. When we do the Pecan income statement, we pull all that into one income statement, but it's housed in the pharmacy area that's dedicated to therapy. They'll get charged the rent expense for physical therapy.
But I guess what Paul's saying is we're going to actually write checks for $72,000. We're showing here that we have $20,000 budgeted. where's the other $52,000, roughly?
That's right.
Where's the $52,000 that should be on line 25 there?
There should be, what, 20 in Carpenter, 20 in Peters or the new dock, so that comes up to 60, and then plus pharmacies.
Yeah.
Portion.
Okay.
It'll be in hot places.
And so that is our portion of it.
That is just...
We're going to spend 72, but then the doctors are going to write us check back for their part of renting our...
Yeah, that's just the lab and x-ray portion of the rent.
Right. Does that make sense?
More sense.
Okay. And it looked like our purchase services there on line number 31, mm-hmm. we actually spent $15,000. We only had $8,000 budgeted, and then we're going to come back and budget $10,000. Are we going to be $5,000 upside down on whatever purchase services is?
Let me look at my comment.
Okay.
It's let's see, part of housekeeping annual salaries allocated, and it's lower than, it has to do with... when we do our allocations, David Dixon is in charge of housekeeping, and what he does is he determines which one of our housekeepers are working which area. We take their salary, and then we allocate it out. And I guess this is a different person, as somebody new that's going over to Pecan.
Right.
Plus they have a larger area.
And they have a larger area, yes.
So I understand, right, that we're budgeting $74,000 for Pecan Plantation?
This is just the hospital piece of it.
Okay. Well, I hear people running around saying it doesn't cost us anything. So I see here that we're budgeting money for it. I just want to make sure that people know we are spending money.
Our revenue is greater than our expenses, is what we said.
We're going to send them $75,000, and they're going to send us back about a million, right? Just for a rough figure.
Yeah. What we show you every month is an income statement which has the revenue and the expense. And
that's
our
right.
Revenue
that's
always exceeds our expense.
All those different facets into one page.
2 minutes.
Well, if that includes a lab, I assume that your equipment repairs you're talking about is going to show up somewhere else, and that's why we left it out.
Equipment repairs.
Oh, right here.
We don't have the equipment we have. You actually will see an increase in the maintenance contract, I think. We were paying to repair that piece of equipment whenever it broke down. Now we actually have a maintenance contract. So for that price, they're going to come out and work on it for free no matter what for the year. So anytime it's older, and as it gets older, you...
And the maintenance contracts in what?
It's right here.
Purchase services?
No, see, you see the line right where my cursor is?
Oh, I see.
We didn't have the budget for it last year. We had equipment repairs. This year we'll have a maintenance contract and hopefully no extra repairs.
As they get older, you tend to get maintenance contracts on those. I mean, the standard rate's about $350 an hour plus parts. So one visit can potentially cost you what you would have. Now we're paying almost $5,000, but any repairs, any maintenance is covered. We don't pay another
dime. Everything over there.
Everything's covered. It covers the machine 100%. So anything,
is there more than one machine that we're doing?
It's just mainly the hematology analyzer is the big piece of equipment that's over there. It's pretty costly. And the lasers go out. Those things, you're looking at $60,000 repair to put a new laser in a hematology analyzer. So with the maintenance contract, if it goes out, it's covered. So
notice we don't have the doctors or any of the staff listed here as far as the expenses for.
That's
in
the 501A, Dr. Carpenter's, all of his.
Right, I remember last year we had it separated out.
Yeah.
That's how it's going to be.
Yeah. Monthly, you'll still get the income statement where we pull all that back together and you can look at it on one page where it's all of them. But just budgeting purposes, it's the hospital side. So this is just x-ray, lab, and the services, EKG, PFT, the things that we bill out of the hospital side.
Are we ready to move on?
I am.
Okay. Next department is our plant or maintenance.
see this in the summary, but there's an increase in equipment repairs. We talked about this quite a bit. We're significantly under, for all departments, we're significantly under budget for this year for our equipment repairs. We talked about whether or not we should reduce that even further, but as our plant gets older, we anticipate we're going to have additional repairs, so we budgeted accordingly. So you see about a $3,000 increase there, and maybe some other departments that have increased in repairs. That really is just a function of our older building. You see we're under budget there. We came in under budget. Steve's done a really good job this year, but we didn't necessarily cut his budget back to just actual this year. We anticipate we'll be spending a little bit more.
And what's this purchase services there?
It's Stat Biomedical. It is $22,000, almost $23,000. Aramark, Carson Pest Control, ThyssenKrupp, our lawn service. And then there were some other things that we don't have every month, but they were in there, Atlas Door, Boyd Plumbing,
right.
So on and so forth.
That's the people who bring the rugs and stuff for the floor, I think. Isn't that right?
Who's that?
Who?
Aramark.
Those are our uniforms and okay. Our
senior.
Yeah.
And what's that Stat Biomedical?
Medical is John Hamby. All of our equipment has to be tested quarterly. Just to kind of, for instance, centrifuges in the lab have to be tested that they're spinning at what they say they are, and then the electrical checkoffs that there's no bad cords and there's no. Right. And plus, he does a lot of repairs and maintenance on yes. on different things around right. Hospital beds, cardio. He's kind of our, if something breaks and it's so old that we can't find parts for, you call John and he can go out on eBay and usually find something to read. He's pretty handy, so.
And it costs him more because he also provides the same service to several other hospitals. He really does a good job.
Next is transportation. Not a lot going on here. We did decrease the budget for fuel.
We have a license.
Texas,
why do you do
that? Don't have to mom. Matter of fact, speaking of that, I noticed that we've got a truck that says Somervell County.
Oh, yeah.
Did the county give us that? Did we buy it from the county, or did it just?
It's been here about as long as I've been here. So
I should say exactly
through the history on
it. So the county just didn't get it back when they.
I don't know.
I was curious about
that.
It's been here in excess of what, eight or nine? I've been here almost 10 years, and it's been here in excess of that. So.
We can probably assume the county wrote a check to help the hospital out one day and sent it to pick up and kept it.
That'd be a stretch, I think.
Next department is our dietary.
The increase in salary there is increase in dietitian coverage primarily.
Yeah, and Elizabeth Falls, she was a PRN. She's now part-time, so I threw some in for payroll tax. I have no idea if she's going to be doing health insurance or
she's not,
or
she's
anything
not.
Else. Did she say no? Okay,
she said.
Good. Sorry. This one, the purchase services, what we pay the nursing home for the meals that come over for the patients and whatever else.
What's vending concepts?
It's our delicious coffee and some other things. Pardon?
I didn't notice a coin slot in the machine. I realized that's who it was.
All right, next department, nursing admin.
Line 9, a huge variation there between our budget last year. Remember last year we had a locums nursing, so there wasn't any benefits associated with it. But all in all, there's still a significant decrease in expense there. Part of that is on the med surge, now having the same med surge, the same person covering med surge and the emergency room has cut that expense significantly.
And also, you'll see on line 23 where it says rent software, we use, it's Axion, I believe is what you said, Dawn? Axion? Is that what the tech uses or used?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, it's now moved over to employee health, which is the department that was actually using it. And it's not costing us what it was. So that's why you'll see the, it looks really hokey here, $17,000 is what we spent this year. But we're not going to spend anything in this department. We've moved it over to employee health, and I think now it's only about $10,000. So it's changed.
And we're talking about ditching it, right?
Can't, got a contract.
Until that's the contract, yeah. We have about another year on the
year,
thing.
Yeah.
But at that year point, we've got a decision.
Mm-hmm. Moving on to MedSurge. In this department, we have Kat Placid, who is both director of MedSurge and ER, so we're allocating some of her salary to each department. Really had to play with the numbers here because some of the people that were here are no longer here. Rob Richards, you know, was in our MedSurge department. So it's kind of hard to do the budgeting for salaries, but this is the best we could do.
I still had a significant shift from LVNs to RNs.
We did. Oh, yeah. We did.
Several.
Yeah.
Yes. The major hospitals are all, if they haven't announced yet, yesterday was the last RN that's getting a job in a hospital.
LVN?
I mean, LVN.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying. Last day.
Yeah, you can see how our budget has flip-flopped here for LVN salary as opposed to RN salary.
See, that's our routine revenue, you know, our room and board. You can see we just left that flat.
He's talking about this first line over here.
Okay.
Hence our increase there is nearly all salary.
Yes.
Next is our swing bed. And we did adjust the revenue in this department, but we are expecting to see more swing bed revenue. It wasn't budgeted for at all last year.
Just started, when was it, November?
October, November
was our first swing bed budget, mm-hmm. So it's a new program.
It's kind of, it's been nice too if we're slow. I mean, if we can put a swing bed patient in there, then we at least are using a room and using the services of the nurses that are already here, so.
It's probably the survey number on the revenue.
And the nursing home didn't cry about that like I expected them to.
Yeah, they're not happy all the time. It depends on what their census is and what how many swing bed patients they think we
have.
I
didn't realize I expected a phone call at home type deal, yeah. And then never get one, so.
No, we talked to them about it. Yeah. We've explained, you know, that and I would say that some hospitals, and you know, really use that as a, you know, as a revenue driver. You know, we've tried to be fair in terms of our dealing with nursing home.
Well, then people get a choice.
Well, I'll tell you my census from the community is the people that are 70 now are not old. 20 years ago, I think people that were 70 felt like they were old, but I think people now that are 70 don't feel old. And I think now when you tell a 70-year-old that they need to go to the nursing home for some rehab type stuff, they're not old enough to go to the nursing home. If you tell them they go to the hospital and do some rehab, they want directions. And that's been the story I've gotten in town. Oh, I'm so glad y'all got that. I didn't want to go to the nursing home to do this because I'm not old enough. I didn't want to be around those old people. And
there is a definite, even though provide similar, there's a definite stigma with going to the nursing home.
I think there is.
For
and it's been real positive, though, I think.
All right, I'm going to move on to ER. So we're only about a third of the way through here. This is our ER department, so the top eight lines are the revenue.
Blue line A, you can see that, you know, our actual revenue compared to budget is, you know, very one half
billion. Right, this one. This this line down here, this is our MCARE, this is the, what we pay for our doctors in the ER. I'm gonna move it up just a little bit so you can see that, there's been an increase in that net revenue, 200,000, and a decrease in an expense of 148,000.
Is that just due to, what would you call it, traffic?
Yeah, proper property is going to increase volume, yes.
Well, explain to them about that crazy deal where if we hit like a certain number of patients per month, our expense goes down.
It does.
I mean, it's like hitting the lottery.
Yeah, there's, on that purchase services, there's an incentive piece in there that the greater the volume for MCARE, the lower our subsidy. So, so we get, you know, we'd have around 750, you know, 800 visits a month.
And that doesn't matter whether they pay or not.
That's correct.
I think we still need about the 20th of the month look and see where we are and tell the board about round up some indigents.
Next we have observation.
No additional expense, there's just revenue and a deduction from revenue.
Next department is case management, social services.
We'll talk about that top line just a little bit. You know, there's an increase in our budget over there, but that, that this is money well spent. This is, you know, these are people that help us, you know, help us get patients in and get them discharged, but also make sure that whenever, you know, we got a patient in, that they're meeting the criteria for admission, they're meeting the criteria for transferring over to the swing bed or to from OBS to inpatient. But this is a, this is one of those parts that's kind of growing in the hospitals as Medicare and the RACs get more aggressive in trying to recapture their revenue. You know, this is a department that that's really important to hospitals.
Next department is surgery.
So what happened to line two? Where we budgeted 15 grand and then spent 100 grand.
Line two?
That's revenue.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's revenue, yeah.
Line five.
Yeah. I suspect, I suspect, Donnie, you know, I suspect that has to do with orthopedics. I'm not absolutely certain.
Yeah, it depends on the state type and how they register them as to where they fall in those lines.
It's only five. Right. Move down a little bit so you guys can see the bottom of it. Should I move on?
Yes. And they use no oxygen in surgery? Oh, that's odd.
That'll fall under respiratory.
Yes, oh, in the cardio department, yeah. Yeah, we don't use any oxygen. What did Dr. Hook say?
To bring their own in.
Yeah.
I like that.
BYOO, bring your own oxygen.
All right, this is a recovery. The only expense here is salaries. And if somebody says something, I'm moving on. Anesthesia. This service here, this is what we pay Dr. Green. We went to lab.
looks like Michael saved about $300,000 just in his on line three there, right?
That's a loss.
That's a these are all revenue. This is revenue. If the structure of three is revenue.
That's inpatient volume, so that when we don't have as many inpatients, it hurts us too.
So Michael goes there and lost $300,000.
But he also did have a decrease in expense of $152,000. So. Yeah. This line here, no budget because our Abbott lease was up in March, so we won't have that next year. Okay. Yay, right?
What was the Abbott lease for?
Chemistry analyzer.
And it was a lease to own, we now own it?
Yeah, most of the stuff in the lab, we try to do a 5-year lease with a dollar buyout, so that way when the contract is done, we pay a dollar, we own it, because a lot of it will run more than 5 years, so we get the free. You can get a little bit cheaper, but then you pay for every year you have it. You can set them up different ways. But for as long as we keep equipment, it benefits us to do the 5-year and then own it, and then we get the free years at the tail end, so we don't have to continue to pay.
Next is lab luminant. I really don't know why we have this revenue line, but we don't use it. What was that before?
Originally, it probably hit there, but now we move it over into general.
Oh, okay.
One of the issues that we ran into is stuff was hitting and then going through DNA, so now we broke off the cash payments. So in other words, if we get, that's why like Quest, you'll see it over in general, because Quest pays us cash, so you don't want to take cash and run it through discounts and allowances and only get 30% when it's 100%.
But now our revenue out there should increase pretty good this next year, because they're going to have two outages.
It's a two outage year, so we should see some increase there. You've got kind of the flip-flop here. You can see where they've started kind of breaking nursing out of the... We have two areas that we have out there. We have Occ Health Nursing, and then we have collections for drug screens. So
right.
Now we're starting to kind of break that nursing out from the collections, so we can... It's been amazing to see this year, as you've got department directors more involved in the budgeting process. Everybody wants their stuff broken. We're getting into dividing paper out in different areas.
Right.
This is true.
Yeah. Yeah, but it's a good thing. I mean, it's kind of what you want to see, is you have departments starting to own their budget now and be accountable for their budget. So
don't dare make a copy in another department.
I
get calls every month to move.
Yeah, the water's a tough suit we have.
Yeah,
water,
yeah.
Water,
yeah.
Water, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm on. Coffee. Right. Moving on to blood.
That's
right. Mike, would you not agree that the reagents, since there's no expense here, is probably just hitting under the main lab?
Yeah, so they key them in, and they're probably hitting under the reagent costs in the core lab. They're not breaking. Whenever they key the invoice in, they're not breaking out. Which is fine, as long as the cost follows the expense, more or less. I mean, this is just kind of a subsidiary of the lab, so.
Okay. This is radiology. Oops, sorry. Leah Ratliff is our department director, and she's the one that helped with this. So there were a couple things that she had put on there as far as rent equipment. She said that we won't have any rent equipment this year. And she asked us to true up for the actual cost of the AGFA service contract. Bottom line is here. All right. Nuke Med.
Her revenue went down $133,000.
Well, in this department, now Leah has several departments. She has NewtMed, DEXA, Ultra, Holter, blah, blah, blah. And you'll see, so when she looks at her financials, she's really looking at the consolidated one.
Right.
And when it's broken out like this, you can, that revenue is probably hitting somewhere else in, within her departments.
Scroll up, see how much that was in, but yeah. See there, there's
46,000.
Right.
So on your regular income statement, that inpatient number you see that's inpatient, outpatient, that's scattered out amongst all these departments.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. NewtMed's another one for departments. Okay, DEXA is another one. Ultra. The one of her CT scan.
Interested to know if the Moncrief involvement in the community has opened the awareness in the community for MAMO. I mean, you look at the MAMO increase. Your budget at $317,000, we jumped up to $487,000.
Mm-hmm. Of course, we get reimbursed for the ones that
we get reimbursed for the ones we do for them.
Right.
But just the general community awareness of going and getting a, you know, insured or not. I would just be interested to know if that's what attributed to that, or just awareness in general.
And her last department of year, MRI.
I wonder if somebody could pull those numbers and see how many we did the day before, for the 12 months before Moncrief.
Well, that started. I realized that number that was budgeted was pretty much last year's annual. That's what we made
right.
last year in that department. So you're seeing one year,
right.
for the most part, one year to the next. So.
Right.
And we could get the number of tests. The number of tests.
Yeah. How many tests
last year? Well, that'd be nice for Lisa to have that on Friday.
Yeah.
Okay, now we're moving on to cardio. Cardio also has several different departments.
That inpatient's kind of interesting there. Mm-hmm. Their volume went up, but on the inpatient with the other departments, not so much. That's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm.
More respiratory illness,
respiratory
I guess.
Respiratory is our highest
yeah.
admission.
Yeah. Probably just we got patients from the beginning.
Kim did mention that we, you were asking about oxygen, and she did mention that there's supposed to be a 5% increase, so we just added that to what we've actually spent this year, or what we expect to spend this year.
How many tabs you got there?
Yeah. And this is the only hospital we still have to go through. Okay, EKG.
A little information about that EKG. We talked about that. And of course, the inpatient, we understand. I mean, that's volume related. But also, you know, a fair amount of our EKGs now are being done in the doctor's office as opposed to up here. So we're getting the revenue, but it's through a 518.
Do we get the same percentage if they're done in the doctor's office versus done in our lab?
Paid the same?
Yeah.
I don't know the answer to that.
Susan, that was
yeah.
brought up in the discussion yesterday,
yeah.
I think. Looking.
We're researching that to
okay.
find out because it depends on if it's.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. Don't want to cut my nose off, so
yeah.
I can
put it out. Oh, I understand. I can tell you though that Dr. Hutchinson is an example, and Pecan is an example. They, well, not Pecan because it's the hospital, but Hutchinson does hers in the house. And
well, and maybe with internal medicine, maybe I'd have a different thought than I would the family practice. You know what I mean? But
I think it's
snacks.
Oh, I'm sorry. We're talking pizza over here. I'm so hungry.
Me too.
I'm sorry. I was thinking, why didn't I order pizza? And I was thinking pizza and beer. We could have just shut the door, but pizza would have been fine too. All right. So this is EEG. Not a lot there. Stress.
Oh, wonderful department.
Kelly said stress. Yes, she's got stress. Polter.
Another one of those.
I know. You keep repeating everything I said. Sorry.
Another one of those departments that has a real capital need. Our number of polters. Polter monitors.
Next department's echo. And pharmacy. You'll see a switch in the payroll categories. Tech is no longer here. Tracy Wood's taken over that position, and she's LVN, so you'll see how it's shifted there.
So where's the pharmacist's salary in there?
Down at the bottom, Luker number, he's line number 33.
He's not here.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I said tech. You know what I was thinking? The pharmacy tech. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
We don't have a full-time pharmacist. We just have a service pharmacist.
Almost a PRN type arrangement.
And we were talking about Omnicell and the where we had moved it over from MedSurge, and it was budgeted for $10,000. It's really actually $7,800 this year. So, all right, employee health. And this is the one, I'm sorry, what?
I'm just wondering what caused that to jump up so much.
Actually, you went from up top, you had an RN salary, and we moved to an LVN. It's another one of those that we flipped. So, you notice there's no budget under the RN, and it moved down to the LVN.
Right.
So it's actually cheaper.
And this is the department where the other part of the flu shots are hitting. We're talking about the flu shots a little bit.
And the LVNs can handle all the meds?
No, this is employee health.
It's an employee health.
Oh, okay. Well, the same thing about pharmacy.
Pharmacy, it just takes a pharmacy tech.
She was a combination of LVN and pharmacy tech. She had dual.
She has a pharmacy tech certification.
Next is physical therapy. And you can see we've budgeted a lot more here. They did really well in physical therapy and the revenue.
And that's where that additional revenue is about to pop a bit.
So is that additional revenue based on the jump that happened this last year? You think we're going to have the same kind of jump this year?
Well, because we're adding services out of the problem.
Okay.
And also swing bed. I mean, swing bed is, you know.
Yeah.
Swing bed is heavy on therapies.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a pretty big jump, though.
Okay.
You may take it off.
Occupational. Therapy. And the last therapy is the speech therapy. Imaging, there's nothing, I don't know. I'm wondering, is something got to miss code, because we don't even use that, so that probably needs to be removed. Here's our implants. We are trying to do, we've made some changes in implants. You can see it looks like we've got a huge loss. Look at our revenue as opposed to our cost here. The problem was with some of our coding, we were, some of the implant revenues was getting coded to surgery instead of implant departments. So it looks really skewed here, but we've made some changes, and so going forward you should see
a lot more revenue hitting in here.
The goal of this department was, say we do a total knee and OR, we wanted to see what we paid for the implant, or what we had to pay and what we got paid, to make sure that we're getting more than what we're...
Excel or QuickBooks won't you let you do it on a job by Josh?
Well, here's the problem. The problem we run into a lot is Medicare will pay for the whole thing, but won't itemize your... won't give you a breakdown. They don't pay specific. Some insurances pay specifically for the implant, where some insurances just write you, it's kind of like a DRG, and they pay you $10,000 for everything. So you,
right,
you've got to look at the whole surgery and see whether you made money and not just the implant. Where, you know, the ones that break it out by the implant, you can see that if you charged or spent $10,000 for an implant and got paid $14,000, right, you know. But some of them, it gets pretty convoluted whenever they
bundle.
Whenever they bundle everything together.
Next is our volunteer department, which is really our gift shop and Sharon Lawler's popcorn sales. So she's doing a great job.
Yes, she is.
And then accounting. $54 is our indigent.
What was our indigent? I mean, is that a fairly static number, or does it bounce around some?
It does bounce around some. It really
for some
does.
Reason, I'm thinking 14 was slightly higher than that, and the 13 was slightly higher than that. That it had been somewhat on a decrease. Is that
well, you know, they put some procedures in place when we first took over indigent, and I didn't even realize this. Charlotte told me recently that when we first took over indigent, the county was paying for indigent care, and when we took it over, we realized, Joe and Charlotte realized, that a lot of the addresses were not even people living within our county. They had moved, but they were still getting paid indigent. Yeah, so they've made a lot of changes to that, put some procedures in place, so we've had less expense than that.
So now they're over in bad debt. Yeah.
Okay. Right. Okay. Well,
I think the county is still doesn't understand that they can bill us for the expenses, because they still have in their budget items for paying for health care for people that are in jail.
They got to pay.
Well, they have to pay for this.
It's 286. Right.
That's a separate thing.
From their last meeting, it didn't sound like they knew about that.
Yeah, 286 states that if there's an inmate incarcerated, they've got to pay us for.
Right, but I don't think they understood that, or they hadn't gone back and billed us for anything.
We negotiate rates
for some reason.
Yeah,
I didn't understand.
We bill them for services. So whenever, say, inmates don't necessarily fall under indigent. They're under the custody of the jail. So say somebody's got to come over for chest pain, they come over and we actually bill the jail an ER visit. They get billed from us for that visit. Now we have worked out a negotiated
structured fee
for being that it's within the county, and we're not going to charge them 100% of
same with clinic expense,
because it's a cash.
So why do we have to make a deal with them instead of the person? If the person's indigent, couldn't they fill out paperwork?
The person's in custody.
If they went through the process and did the paperwork and got declared indigent, then indigent would cover it.
Then the county wouldn't have to pay for that, right?
Well, but the biggest problem is,
you know, if they're indigent, we pay for it.
Right. The district would, but not the county.
Not the county.
Yeah. But the hospital district would.
Yeah.
Right now it's reversed.
Yeah. Now the jail's paying us for the people that they bring over.
They're in custody. It's the jail's responsibility.
Yeah, to cover their medical costs.
Not county
indigent.
Because I was thinking, if I had insurance and I was in jail and I needed health care, I'd just pull out my insurance card and go here.
Don't
do it.
No.
You're under their custody, so.
But the Hood County ladies in our jail,
most of them
aren't for our county.
No.
And that's why we build a jail.
Right. But if they did show up here indigent, we could send a bill to Hood County and maybe get
sure. Yeah. No, we have to. They have to pay us.
Yeah, but as long as they're in jail, we can get the county to pay for it.
Just like they do.
Let Danny worry.
Hey, let's start having our indigent all picked up and taken to jail.
There you go.
Awesome.
Ding, 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 ding.
How about if we just call a deputy down and ask him to hit him and see if he can get arrested? Then go ahead.
Okay, let's go. The last department for the hospital is our general account. These lines are blank up here because we've moved the room and board over to MedSurg. So So all those numbers you've actually already looked at. So all you see here are the following expenses and then some of our other income. And Ray, did you want to speak about the other income?
Yeah,
is there something
well, we've got all the other income. The big number there is the tax revenue number, the M&O and the IDS, and we have left those exactly as we collected this year. We'll talk about it some more, but as you know now, the value that the Central Appraisal District put on the plant is significantly higher than it was this previous year. Of course, the plants feel that, and their numbers come in significantly lower. So we met with the attorney Monday to determine what value we should put on the plant for purposes of budgeting. And we've agreed that we'll use the same value as we did last year for the plant. Now that'll mean that the same value at the same tax rate, we get a little bit of an increase in revenue because there's been an increase in the other real estate other than the plant. But the plant's the big number. Now, with that, I guess there's two things that could happen, is that the value could come in above what it was last year, if that had the final number that we settle on with them, or that the CAD settles, if that's the case, we'd get additional revenue. The other is, if it comes in lower than that, if it comes in lower, there'll in all likelihood be it'll go to court. Then the plant is required to pay us the value that they submitted to the CAD. Yeah, and they're required to pay us that by January 31st for pay a penalty. So that's yet to be determined, and we're not sure when we'll know the absolute value on that. But for budgeting purposes, we're going to go forward with the value that we had last year, and it'll generate approximately the same amount of the same tax rate would generate. Approximately the same amount of revenue.
Meaningful use, we're done with that.
Yeah.
And also our EPL program.
That's the two big numbers in terms of looking at last year's budget compared to this year's budget and next year's budget is, meaningful use is a big one. That's gone away. Or the hospital. 501A still gets some meaningful use revenue, but the hospital doesn't. The other big hit, which we talked about several times, is the UPL program, the program we have with Boehner, and that's gone away. And you add those two together, that's $1 million. So that's $1 million that's going out of our other revenue.
And so far we haven't collected as much on the 1115.
Yeah, 1115, we don't know what that is. Because we keep getting the haircuts on that. We budgeted $750,000 last year, and we wound up with $600,000. We've got another payment that's coming in. We've left that about $350,000, and we think it's net because you have to send money up and get money back. Mm-hmm. I think that's a conservative number, the 348. But I think, I think the last 2 years has kind of caused us to take a little more conservative approach of what we think we're going to get paid by the government programs. So that's where we.
Would it maybe be a better idea to put those in a different category other than income and? If we get it, and we don't. Because I think we've had this conversation a dozen times that, we're waiting on the government,
Yeah.
Well,
and they're represented below the bottom line on the income statement.
Right.
But, the problem is, if you take that $350,000 out, then you got a $350,000 shortfall that's got to come from somewhere.
Right.
We know we're going to be somebody, and we're being much more conservative this year than we've been last year and certainly the year before.
Yeah.
You fill out every year.
After losing $1 million, I think that's a good idea.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, we've run it the last couple of years.
So on the internet, if you scroll up a little bit, there was an internet thing there. Internet cable TV.
Cable. Internet cable.
We went from a negative budget to a
huge
budget.
Yeah. We got some credits on for some reason. I don't know if it's I think it was because we discontinued some of our cable or something service. Oh, and our internet also. We got rid of the what was that thing called? Internet thingy. There's a word for it. I can't remember what Carrie said. He said an Ethernet or something. Oh, do you know what I'm talking about?
Was it the Wi-Fi?
No, he moved one from one company. We have two systems in place. We have a redundant backup in case there's outages. But he moved, I'm trying to think, it's been a while back. But he moved from one company to another, and we had a savings with that. And then he moved our redundant company to a different one as well, or slid it over to the primary company that we were using. And a lot of that could have been with us.
Okay, so that's it for it. I didn't know if we need to go back in summary or whatever.
I saw our tobacco money on there. Did we ever figure out where our 2013-14 tobacco money went?
It was apparently too late to go back and worry about that. Once it's done, it's done. They had already allocated out the funds, and it's over.
Right.
So.
Okay.
We did receive notification that we passed the audit on the tobacco funding for this year. Mm-hmm. We can expect to have it funded next year.
Yes. All right. Moving on to the clinic. A lot less tabs here.
Yeah. 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 This is a tough one, but I mean, the revenue, we had good revenue there on the clinic. The clinic is the revenue that the physicians generate in their offices. And in the hospital is the revenue they generate from seeing patients in the hospitals and are doing procedures. There's not any lab or x-ray or at the NEO. And this is always the challenge with the 501As. We've talked about this in the past. Some of the challenge is that, you know, that historically, you know, not just for us, but for all, you know, the 501As generally lose money. You know, we've talked about what that number should be per physician. But where you make it up is you make it up on the revenue that the physicians generate for you in the hospital, either through procedures if it's a surgeon or through admissions and lab and x-ray and the other ancillary revenues in the hospital.
All right, so should we start with the Davis?
Yeah, let's go through them, yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
The first two lines are clinic and hospital revenue. Below that, the expense. On the salaries, we used his salary per the contract. Added together with PTO, this is split between salary and PTO line, but that's per the contract.
Yeah, add the two together gives you the total salary because
right.
We have doctors out on PTO, we don't bring anybody in to replace them, so we just move it from salary expense to PTO expense, so that's the total salary.
Right. Let's see. Going through some of the expenses. Well, now this is where the clerical salaries for the doctors will hit over here on these clerical lines. Also, even though it says clerical, that also includes any, not here.
Nurse.
Thank you,
yeah.
Thank you.
Nurse practitioner or
thank
physician
you.
Assistant, yeah.
The clinic revenue and the hospital revenue here for each doctor, is that net or gross?
No, that's gross up there and instead of down
the bottom. Down the bottom, you'll see the discounts and allowance.
Yes, okay, it's on the next page.
Right. Do we need to take a break? I'm sorry. Do we need to take a break, guys?
Yes.
I'm so sorry. Sorry.
I'm going to take a break. Y'all do better control.
Jeez.
We're so close to being
done.
All right.
Oh, yeah,
we're all. And how many tabs are there?
There's only 115 of them, isn't there?
If you remember the last budget, you know that's the end of the book. The end of the year.
They're so cute, your comments are so cute.
It's only because I have a wedding coming in soon.
Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. And we got that rain, so maybe it'll be green.
I know it. And I was talking to, as I was coming in this morning, I went and called him because it was raining.
Mm-hmm.
And he just put fertilizer out.
Nice.
So the grass should be really pretty.
That's great. I'm so glad.
I said, too bad we didn't get that fertilizer out. And he goes, well, I don't know what mouse you have in your pocket. I got it out this week when you were at work until 8 o'clock. Oh, okay.
That is great.
Yes.
I'm so glad he was able
I'm
to
excited.
Do that. Absolutely.
I'm so not used to your hair being straight.
It's so flat.
Next week.
Mm-hmm.
so hungry.
I know, I'm hungry, I'm ready to get I'll get a paper, digital copy, you gonna send us this? Or you have to wait for the paper? Can I get a digital copy? When you get ready to hand out, can I get a digital one?
Yes, absolutely.
I love it, that saved me so much time over the last year, when I go look something up. I used to grab the thing off my OneDrive, or I grab a paper copy off the shelf, one of the two.
Well, I think we'll have hard copy of this by the meeting next Thursday, right?
Well, I mean, y'all could have I could send this in an email.
Right.
If y'all want to see it, it just depends on what you want, I guess, if you want.
I would like it in an email, because I've already about ran out of room on my clipboard here for notes.
Okay.
Just keep in mind, it'll be until.
Right.
No, until approval day,
it'll be for
this is all.
I mean, you tweak and you every time. Becky's learned every time you look at it, you find.
It'll change 12 times.
Like I said, when I found it after we approved it, I'll look at it going.
Now, is this the same format we used last year? This is a different format than we used last year.
No, it's the same.
She's got more comments than I did.
It's prettier.
Yeah, like she's prettier. It's just pretty idealized.
It's prettier than
mine. Well, some kids' departments, they're 2 digits, 3 digits, I don't know.
I actually read them.
Yeah, this, plus if we were to print this off, some of my notes here are rather long, so it'd probably be easier if y'all looked at it.
I understand.
Yeah, I assumed early on when you were having
when you print those, notes don't come out right half the time.
You're having 2% on most of the salary-related things, on most of them. I assumed the 2% on the actual salaries was actually out there, just off-screen.
It's included on here. Well, here, let me go up to mine. Well,
we'll
come up there. Let's see.
Yeah, but back when we were starting out, I've seen a lot of the 2% down on PTO and all
like
that.
Oh, you mean, yes.
So I assume that somewhere out there, we actually did get the 2% on
that,
too.
Yes, it's all done in each one of those.
Make it real quick, that summary, just for you.
All right.
Hang on,
no, we're going backwards.
I don't think everybody's back yet. Okay.
Rolling.
Yeah,
you can
join.
Okay. Thank you. All right, y'all ready?
Mm-hmm.
Who are y'all waiting for? Don't wait on us.
I was actually waiting on Dr. Burrows.
Oh. Go.
Didn't you just come back?
No. I'm back. But I'm back now. Okay. It's all good.
Okay, I want to just point out down at the bottom just a little bit. I guess I always feel like, you know, I get a little bit defensive with the 501A since it loses money. But I point out a couple of things there. You'll see the as we stand right now, the budget lost $1,180,000 compared to budget, significantly low budget, but really about a $400,000 reduction from actual performance this past year to what we're budgeting for. So we're looking for improvement there. And that's reflected in our budgets.
So does that mean Susan's picking them up over there and getting more out of them or something?
Well, I think we're working hard to increase the volume of the patients that the doctors see.
Right.
Better billing and more time billing.
Right.
And so, Dr. Davis, I guess
okay.
Let me make a comment about this too. The risk of picking a fuss, but I just feel like it's important for me to say this. Rolling down so we can see the doctor's salaries.
Their salaries?
There's the doctor's salaries. That's what they're paid.
Right.
And you'll see that for each doctor. I guess the point that I want to make is why we think that's a confidential number. And there's really two or three reasons for that. You know, the primary reason is we have significant competition from Lake Granbury, trying to recruit our doctors. So it makes it even more difficult for us to keep those doctors if they know exactly what they're getting paid. And then the other is, you know, a concern from the physicians. The physicians are telling me that if their salaries are public, it makes the patient-doctor relationship more difficult. And that's what they're telling me. So I just want to encourage you that if you're seeing the numbers, let's keep the doctor's salaries, you know, confidential among ourselves. And I'll just ask you to do that.
Okay. Well, but our budget has to be published. We can't keep it private.
You can figure it out.
I understand.
Yep.
I'm just pointing that out.
Sure.
And if somebody wants to dig and find it, right.
Like a dig and find.
But we have no plan on putting in the newspaper saying, hey, guess what, they all might go $100,000.
I heard say, Ray's saying, don't go out on the street corner and, you know, hold up a sign.
Okay.
There's a couple of line items that are in their contract, dues and subscriptions, so we just put in whatever was in their contract. Also, the educational fees, $2,500, and this includes tuition, lodging, meals, and travel expenses. So each doctor, it's negotiated per doctor. Any questions on that one or not?
And the rent building is for wherever they are.
Wherever that practice is.
Their actual office and patient rooms are.
Yeah.
Okay.
Of course, with the negative number here, in theory, all the places we saw where we were below budget and making money and increasing revenue in the first 20 is an offset from the negative number of Dr. Davis's practice, because his practice doesn't make money.
He makes money the hospital.
He makes money by having people in the hospital and having tests done and that blah.
Every provider feeds that
hospital. Right.
And you'll see some that are doing better than others, and that's just function of the practice's function, maybe how many patients they've been in the hospital.
But Dr. Davis is in normal revenue, there's what, about $1,050,000?
Oh, I'm sorry, I switched tabs.
$1,060,000, and then you got your $500,000 down there below. So you actually did clear about $500,000 before his expenses.
Yes.
Okay.
It's kind of hard to do it when they're on separate pages, but.
Right.
This is Dr. Carpenter. So once again, his salary, you can see that between salary and PTO per his contract. His was negotiated a little differently for whatever reason, I don't know, but it was for $5,000, which I just split between travel and educational fees. It doesn't have to be, I could have put just $5,000 in one, I guess. It doesn't really matter, but that's why it's broken out. And why this is more is that was negotiated in his contract.
Right.
I think part of that, just to clarify, is because of his medical directorship that he has out at the power plant requires him to have more CMEs, not to mention the fact that he puts in a lot of hours in the ER, which there's also requirements for the doctors to have additional education and training to work the ER as well.
He's got an MRO. I don't know if it's a certification or a certificate, but he's an MRO.
Yes, certification.
He's a medical review officer for the plant, so he's got to have the additional drug testing and have knowledge of all the street drugs and what people are on. And
you will notice on at the bottom here, he does have other income from Luminant.
That comes into us, yeah. That is a red that comes into us, yeah.
Okay, Dr. Hutch.
She is an intern. This generates, you know, I wouldn't say significant, but certainly generates more hospital revenue than your average kind of practitioner.
Well, I don't know. Dr. Burroughs does a lot more admissions than some.
That's why he said average.
She's not average. That was careful the way I said that. Yeah. I knew what I was saying. Yeah. Good boy.
DRG basis, she's probably taking care of sicker people that are going to make more.
More
money
off of treating more disease.
DRG level.
Of course, Dr. Hayes not here any longer, so we're moving on. Well, to Dr. Peters. Who also is not here any longer.
This says Dr. Peters will be gone back, and this is the new physician.
There you go.
I'm sorry.
That in theory would take his
place.
Let's call
it Dr. Khan. Yeah.
We adjusted the revenue up to
up here.
Reflect that.
Dr. Oak.
Has there been any bites on our search?
Yeah, there has. We got a bite on a husband and wife couple. So nothing. It's just a pretty good lead.
Mm-hmm. I got a nice email from the recruiter recruiting me for it.
There you go. All right.
Well,
we'll
be glad to negotiate.
We know they're working.
Next is Dr. Patino.
Well, for some reason, I didn't realize he was part of the 501A. I was...
No.
He's part-time. He's a part-time 501A.
Yeah. Just in my mind, though, I thought he was doing something else.
And the salary reflects the part-time status.
Going down to the bottom here.
And see, you know, he's doing more work, and you see that that from an actual standpoint to a budget standpoint, we're budgeting a significant improvement in his practice.
Dr. Turk?
Yeah. We're going for a Dr. Turk. We're starting Dr. Turk. We'll be here through next September. So that's what we're reflecting in the budget.
Dr. Lawton's next.
Yeah, Dr. Lawton. I mean, I think it's one that we're going to have to really think hard about in terms of where we go with his practice and whether or not that's a practice that's going to grow or not. And you see the number kind of reflects that down at the bottom. We go down to the bottom number. There's a pretty significant loss. So I think that's.
But now comparing Dr. Patino's not fair at all. It would be more fair to compare him to.
Dr. Hutchinson, that's correct.
Exactly. And we don't want to do that either, so.
Yeah. Well, there's, yeah.
Right.
Dr. Bosick is next.
Roughly, what's his patient volume at this point in his practice?
He is full. I mean, he is, we're not having any problems filling him up.
Right.
And he's gotten his credentialing and has started covering ER. And I know he was doing like three different shifts back to back.
Well, so, I think just his timing of his coming, I think, with his involvement in the school and stuff, I think it's going nowhere but up.
I agree, and he's an easy sell to the community because he relates to this community, and they've embraced him. So and word of mouth has been great. We haven't had to invest an awful lot in advertising. You know,
right.
We've done things like get him out to the Citizen Center for public speaking, the same at Pecan, even though
right.
He doesn't work at Pecan. Mm-hmm. So we're getting a lot of revenue back for not much of an investment.
Mm-hmm. All right, folks. Last tab.
Okay.
This is just our general department for the clinic.
And you will see there's meaningful use dollars down there in the line 23.
Oh, right.
Yeah, and the meaningful use for the 501A will continue through 2017.
Well, we're talking about that, there's a line item for, I don't know if it was in the ER budget or not, that when we can go back annually and bill the state of Texas for the intubation that we see in our ER. And so that was a pretty decent chunk of change that we were supposed to get from them last year.
Are you talking about trauma?
Trauma.
The trauma grant that we can, last year, I'm going to say it was between 60 and 80,000.
That's what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a line item that we have in the budget for that?
That would have been under that general. I'm trying to think exactly what it's maybe grants under general.
Right.
It's a trauma grant, so that's probably where it would fall.
The only grant under general was that $6,600 fund, though. I don't.
No, this one was a seven-figure number. It was, I think, the year before we'd only gotten $36,000, $38,000 for it, and then we billed it differently or something. For whatever reason, out of all the junk I've had to sign up here, that one had to be notarized. Had to be witnessed, had to be, I mean, just, there was a lot of hoops to jump through for whatever that particular program was.
Yeah, it's a trauma grant. We get it every year. It fluctuates.
I noticed earlier when I looked at this again, I didn't have anything budgeted here for physician recruiting, so I guess we need to plug something in there.
Yes, we do.
And I neglected to do that, sorry.
No, I neglected to give you the...
Yes, it was Susan's fault.
It's my fault.
Maybe let's quickly go back and look at the 501A summary and then the hospice summary, and I'll have a couple of comments we'll make on that.
All right.
From here, we've got about nearly 1.2 million shortfall, and that's going to look at the hospital.
Okay.
Yeah, we're $415,000 favorable there, but the point I wanted to make, if we make the, if we make the two revenue adjustments, if we make the 2% increase in the outpatient revenue, if we make the 5% across the board rate increase, that generates about $800,000 to the bottom line, which would get us up to 1.2, which gets us at a slightly above a break-even budget.
With our tax revenue set at $1,195.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
And we get all the money we got last year.
Well, no.
In theory, we should get more this year.
We should get more.
But it's not budgeted as more this year.
Yeah, we've taken a conservative approach on the other revenue.
So when we shot up and said 2/3 is what they think the plant's valued at, right? And we're going for the total value that was last year. So if we meet somewhere in the middle, say 75%, 80%, something like that.
No. The value of the plant is 2.6, or 2.4 is what the.
1.6.
Oh, sorry.
Amber alert.
Amber alert. See what the CAD 2.6 is what the CAD has placed on the plant.
Right.
And their number is 1.6.
Right.
So. You know, I guess we're kind of coming together saying, okay, we think that if there's a compromise, it'll compromise right at where it was last year.
Which is 1.9. Which is actually a little more on the plant side.
So that's what it was last year. That's what you think we'll end up at this year.
Sir? Okay.
You think that's near where we'll end up at this year.
Yeah. That's where they will wind up. Yeah, that's where they will wind up.
I'm hoping that this report goes before local jury here.
Well.
That's what I'm hoping.
It'll be 150.
If it goes 40 dozen, it's at our courthouse.
Yeah, I think that's a conservative approach, but I also think it's a very realistic approach to what the value of the plant, where the value of the plant's going to end up.
Well, I'll be real honest. I'll tell you what my opinion is, what they're doing, is I think they're rattling their sabers, and I think if we all put our budget out, that we're budgeting them really going to the 1.6, and we accept the fact that it could be at 1.6 and publicly say it may go to 1.6, my fear is it'll go to 1.6.
Well, and that's part of the strategy of the taxing entities of delaying the publishing of our actual tax rates as long as possible. So that they won't, because they don't care what the tax rate is. They care about what the size of the check is that they're writing. So that's been part of the strategy is not, you know, we'll publish our proposed rate, but it's going to be, you know, hopefully higher, you know, than the actual rate. So that's been part of the strategy.
But we don't have to vote to accept our tax rate until October.
October 1.
For October 4th, 3rd or 4th is the absolute last day.
It's the absolute last day. But what I think our lawyer has recommended is that we don't actually take a vote on what our real tax rate is until October 1.
Correct.
And by then, they've lost their negotiating power.
Well, that's what we have. Yeah, now on our, in terms of this discussion, you know, on our next agenda next Thursday, we'll have to approve a proposed tax rate. And what we'd like to see that would go right up to the rollback rate, because, you know, the proposed rate, you can't go higher, you can go lower, but you can't go higher. So you want to make sure that from a proposed rate, which really means nothing except that's what we're initially proposing, you know, you'd like to have that be at the maximum, close to the maximum rate that you could
to the rollback rate.
To the rollback rate.
Right.
And then there's a series of hearings and all that has to take place, and then the vote on the final tax rate is October
1st. And there will be a little bit of fine tuning on this, I'm assuming, maybe
certainly.
Between
yeah.
Here and there. As much as you'd like to be done today, I don't think you are.
No, not quite.
Well, I have a question about the rollback rate. The rollback rate is going to be figured on 1.95, 2.4, or what of their.
It's going to be calculated.
We're figuring our rollback on what it was last year, yeah. 1.9.
Okay, so
we took a conservative. It originally came out at 2.4, but we're taking a step back and estimating it on what it was last year, just in case, because we don't, we assume that, we're assuming that it's not going to be the 2.4. It would be, we'd all be happy and things would be great if it ended up that way, but with what's taking place, you pretty much know that it's not going to be there. So we're taking a conservative approach to.
Yeah, at the same rate we were last year, if it does wind up at the 2.4 ballpark, we get an extra half million. Just roughly.
Yeah, without, that's at the standard tax rate. We get five, it would net us about $500,000.
If we're advertising something about a rollback rate that figures at 1.95, does that mean we're just told that we're not expecting 2.4?
Well, if you put,
no, because we're gonna tell them that this is the maximum rate we charge, and we're gonna discuss this up until October 1st.
Yeah, we have to propose the rate. We have to propose the revenue generator.
Yeah, we don't have to tell them the truth until we actually vote on October 1st.
Okay.
And on September 30th, they lose their ability to negotiate.
The first one's a proposal. We just can't go higher than that.
Right. And you take that to the rollback rate, just to give you that room to fluctuate in between, because the way the calendars work out, if you put it lower and had to go higher, you wouldn't have the meeting time and notice to do it. So by going to the rollback, it gives you that space to move within that where you want it, because, and who knows, you know, what might happen with the plant between now and then. As time, as we move along, we'll learn more and more about what
biggest match thing
we could learn more and more about what's gonna, what are, is it September 1st?
I think we have to be published by September 1st.
Yeah, well, September, the plant has till September 1st to contest it in court. Is that correct? I think that's
September
1st?
No, I don't know the answer to that.
I don't know.
I think it's the 1st of September. I think they have, there's a date there in September around the 1st of the month.
But so far, they've not negotiated at all. They hadn't showed up to any meetings. Yeah. They hadn't answered any emails. They hadn't answered any telephone calls.
And then it's pretty wore up as the paper, but it wasn't sure about now.
Yeah.
I know there's a date out there that they've got to basically go to court and say,
we contest
the rate, and then we'll see what plays out from there.
Right. As long as whatever rollback rate we do publish doesn't make them be able to back figure where we're planning on them being.
Well, the tax rate
is tax rate.
Yeah.
I don't think I'm I care about the size of the check, that's about it.
That's all they care about. Yeah.
Well, from what I understand reading that article, it's not just us that they're doing this to. I think it's every luminant entity in the state of Texas is.
Well, the school actually has the ability this year to lower their rate 4% without changing their budget a dime, because $1.8 million doesn't have to be sent to Robin Hood in recapture money, but they're going to set their tax rate, I believe, at the same rate they had it last year, and just let that go into some sort of fund or anything, you know, as excess, to not show the plant that they could lower their rate by 4%.
Okay, let's talk about the budget a little bit. Okay, for purposes of what we're doing, is there general agreement on the revenue side for us to increase the outpatient revenue by 2% and have a budget of 5% rate increase, and see where that takes us on our budget for our next step?
I don't think we can vote on anything.
No, we can't. He just wants to know
what that means. Just general agreement.
Plug that in and we plug it out for y'all to look at.
I think so too.
Yeah.
And if Becky uses the same format and show us what her last column on the right is, and here's how that column changes if we did what we just said we thought we might want to do.
And our thought is that we'd make those changes, take them to the budget committee Tuesday night for their review of the change. Not go through this whole departmental thing, but really just look at the two summary pages and see what impact that has once we plug those in. And I suspect that we'll want to have at least another meeting of all of you. At least the one, probably more between now and October the 1st, where we ask you to make the final approval.
I do think we need to have another budget workshop to look at it.
I think this is good for all of us. I think nobody else is.
Didn't hurt.
Okay, the next, I think there's another item on the agenda, Mr. Chairman.
All right, review and necessary adopt 2015 hospital district planning calendar.
And I guess we don't have that final one back yet, but we've got the dates, you know, on the main dates that I want to make you aware of is that on the 27th, next Thursday, we have to adopt a proposed tax rate, so that'll be on the agenda. And then we have a couple of postings that we'll need to make on the 3rd and the 10th, that's notice of the public hearings. On September the 14th will be our first public hearing, and that'll be a posted meeting. On September the 17th will be our second public hearing, and that'll be a posted meeting. And then on the also on the 17th we have to post the notice for a hearing on the budget, and then on the 24th we have to post the notice for a tax rate increase, and those are all postings. The attorney is sending us he's written verification of these dates, so there may be a little decision, but I just want to make you aware that we've got the dates, and having a weekly paper is tough.
Handicaps us.
It really does, mm-hmm. Because you got to work backwards, you know, to make sure that you meet all your dates.
Are we going to have all these public meetings really public down in the center, or are we going to have some of them up here?
I think the budget workshops and that kind of stuff we have up here, and I think if it's a one-line deal to work, I don't think we have public comments, and I don't know in some of those meetings whether we need to have public comments, because we are going to have two public hearings. That
now, whether or not you want to have the 3rd and the 10th, if you want to have those public hearings either here or in the at the senior citizen, that's y'all's call. If you remember
I think the public hearings, we ought to have them down at the center.
If it's available, we're
okay. What's the dates on that?
September the 3rd, September the 10th. And September the 14th and September the 14th and September. First public hearing is September 14th. Second public hearing is September the 17th. Those are the two publics. Those are the posting dates.
3 days apart?
Mm-hmm. Tweeted last time. At least three days the minimum. That's where you get involved.
And we have to have public hearings, but we don't have to allow people to do public comments. No.
The 3rd and 10th are posting dates, and 14th and 17th are public hearings.
That's right.
Right.
Yeah.
I think on the 14th and 17th, we have those at the center.
Okay.
And we won't have enough time on the meeting that's on the 14th if nobody shows up to not have it there, because we'll already be posted by the time we have a meeting. So.
And then while you're doing that, we also need to reserve October the 1st.
Right.
Because that'll be our regular meeting is the 24th.
Right.
But then we'll need to reserve October the 1st for the public hearings.
Right.
Approval. That would be the approval of the budget and tax rate.
Right.
I'm sure there'll be other meetings.
Yes.
So are we actually trying to adopt this calendar, or?
Oh, I put adopt. I expected to have the completed sheet from the attorney, and I don't, so I'm not going to ask you to adopt.
Well, I'll tell you what. Why don't we put that on our agenda for the
Next Thursday. Okay.
And we can adopt it at that point. Because I think we do have to vote to adopt that. I don't think we can just do it.
No, I think we need to adopt it.
Yeah, I think we have to take a board action to do that.
Whether you have to or not, I mean, I think from our perspective, we'd like that. We'd like to adopt it.
Yeah. All right.
That's all I have, Mr. Chairman. Thank y'all very much for your time.
Yes.
All right, somebody make a motion to adjourn.
Thank you for all the hard work.
Well, that's right here, Ben. She's the one who deserves the. She did the head lifting. Yeah.
I move we adjourn.
All right, we have a motion. We have a second. We have a second. All in favor, raise your right hand. Show that it passes unanimously with Brett abstaining.
No, I
Brett voted yes. Eugene.
Good
Gene,
forgive that.
No, I will say, I think Becky's doing a fine job. I didn't have a problem with Michael doing it, but I think
sure it's prettier.
I think that was a battery ran out somewhere there.
Well, I really thought that Becky was kind of the brains of the outfit to begin with.
Oh, ow.